Welcome to Candid Conversation number 9. This morning we're going to be talking about the battle of the mind, meaning that, and people don't think about this, but the Christian life isn't about the flesh. Well, I mean, it's about putting down the flesh, but the war for the Christian is an internal war. It's all about the mind. You see, when you look at Christianity as a whole, they're focused on the outside. They're focused on, we want good physical health. We want lots of money. We want to be set. You know, we want God to bless us. And when they say blessing, they're referring to material blessings. People like Joel Osteen saying, have your best life now. And preachers all over the country talking about how if you give God your life, that He will bless you. And they use passages like Romans 8:28, for we know that all things work together for good to them that love the Lord, who are the called according to His purpose. And they'll take that to mean it's everything will work out good in your material life. In other words, if something bad happens, like you lose your job, well, that's okay, because God will give you a new one, and He'll give you a better one. And you just weren't meant to have that job. God had bigger and better things planned for you. When God closes a door, He opens a window. And the window is going to be better than the door, because all things work together for good. And the Christianity as a whole is so focused on the outward. But when you look at Scripture, you look at what God says, especially in Paul's epistles, which are written to us today, you find out that really God is only concerned with the internal situations. And so if anything, if there is any manipulation of circumstances, not saying that there is, but if there is, it would only be for spiritual growth. But you look at passages like Ephesians 6, it says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. In fact, I mentioned Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. Later on in Romans 8, it mentions, nothing shall separate us from the love of God. Shall principalities, powers, and I don't know that verse too well, but basically it's talking about the same thing. That God's concern is that we have the love of God, it be shed abroad in our hearts, and that happens through learning the sound doctrine found in Paul's epistles and allowing Christ to live in us. And then there's nothing that can separate us from that love. The principalities and powers, the forces of Satan cannot separate us from the love of God, which shows you that it's, again, an internal, it's spiritual warfare. It's not a physical thing. And so when you get to Ephesians 6, where it talks about taking on the whole armor of God, the reason you take up the whole armor of God is because you don't wrestle against flesh and blood, you wrestle against those principalities and powers. The battle is one of the mind. In 1 Corinthians 15:31, Paul says that he dies daily. Well, obviously he doesn't die daily physically. I mean, you don't just live and then you die and then God raises you up and the next day you die. What he's talking about is that when you are, before you're saved, Ephesians 2:1 says that you are dead in your trespasses and sins. That your flesh, that your spirit is dead. And then it says God has quickened you together with Christ. And so then you become alive in Christ. Your spirit becomes alive. And God reckons your flesh to be dead. Romans 6:11. And then it's up to you to reckon yourselves also to be dead indeed unto sin and alive unto Christ. And to present your bodies a living sacrifice unto God, which is your reasonable service. Romans 12:1. You still have your vile flesh, according to Philippians 3:21. And so your flesh doesn't change in the sense that you still have a sin nature you still have the ability, or it's still natural for you to sin. You still have the ability to sin and follow the lust of the flesh. But as far as God is concerned, before you're saved, your flesh is alive and your spirit is dead. And after you're saved, your spirit is alive and your flesh is dead. And as far as how God reckons it, because according to Romans 4, he calls those things that be not as though they were. He sees it that that's what will happen in the future in heavenly places, that you will not have the flesh, you will have a glorified flesh. And so he sees you as having that already, and then you can walk in the spirit and not fulfill the lust of the flesh. But yet you still have the capacity to sin. And so what we have to look at, what we have to understand, is that the war isn't with the flesh, because God leaves the flesh alone basically when you're saved, but he makes your spirit alive. And so now the battle after you're saved is to use that live spirit to serve God rather than fulfilling the lust of your flesh, which you did before you were saved. And so that's why he tells you, he focuses on the mind, that we wrestle not against flesh and blood. And then he talks about taking on the whole armor of God, the helmet of salvation. Gird your loins with truth. Have on the breastplate of righteousness. Take the shield of faith. All those are spiritual weapons. And then the sword, the only offensive weapon there in the armor, is the word of God. And so that's what we need to be focusing on. It's a battle of the mind. Over in 2 Corinthians 5, we're told that we walk by faith and not by sight. That the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are spiritual, to the pulling down of strongholds. Paul also tells the Corinthians in another passage that they are to cast down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of Christ. If you look at Lucifer and you see where he went wrong, it was in the mind. It was that he said, I will be like the Most High. I will sit in the congregations on the sides of the north. I will exalt my throne. Everything is about the mind. And that's something we need to focus on, because the world, and especially Christianity, is going to try to get you to focus on the flesh. When you come to their church, they try to get you saved. Getting you saved isn't for them recognizing that you're a sinner and trusting in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for your sins. Their definition of being saved is you were a bad person before you walked in these doors, and now that you are part now we want you to come in and be a regular member of our church. Listen to what the pastor says every Sunday. Give tithes, become a church member, serve in the church, and then you were a bad person and now you're a good person. And when you make that commitment to be part of that church, the first thing they want to do is water baptize you. And they'll say, well, it's an outward manifestation of an inward work of grace. You won't find that anywhere in Scripture. The reason they want to baptize you is because the Scripture says that once you trust in Jesus' death, burial, and resurrection as atonement for your sins, that according to Romans 6, you are buried into Christ's death, and that you were raised in the likeness of his resurrection, that your old man is crucified with him. God says that your flesh is dead. And the problem with that for churches is, according to 1 Timothy 6, is that they love money. And if I don't have a guilty conscience, if I'm not worried about committing sin that will lead me into hell, then I'm not going to give out of fear. The only way I'm going to give in the offering, when I understand sound doctrine today, is a motivation of grace, a motivation of seeing it's the love of Christ that constrains me to judge people in Adam or in Christ, and that money given to the church will help people get into Christ, or help people who are already in Christ come into the knowledge of the truth. And very few people will actually get to that point of grace thinking as their motivation. And since they won't get that far, and then if you remove the guilt, then they have no motivation to give, so they don't give, so then the church doesn't get rich. They don't get the money that they want. So what they have to do then is keep you in the flesh, to keep you thinking, being guilty. And so that you will not recognize the dry baptism of the Holy Spirit into Christ's death the moment you are saved, that it's a dry baptism, they immediately try to tell you that those same verses, where if you read them with an objective mind and use the Holy Spirit that you've been given as a result of being saved, it is clear that that's a dry baptism, yet they want to change those verses to make it sound like it's water, because then that way they can focus on the flesh. It's the flesh is now somehow better because it's been washed, it's been water baptized by the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. And then they focus on the flesh from then on, because it's all about the love of money. But you need to understand as Christians that that's not what the Bible says. That's what man says. The Bible says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they are spiritual. We are told that we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. And when you recognize that it's a battle of the mind, that it's a spiritual battle, then you will recognize the devices of Satan, the corrupting of the Word of God, and then you will take the Bible as your authority and allow God's Word to teach you how you should live, rather than following what Christianity says when it goes against God's Word. And a great way to think of it in terms of the Christian life, it's not following a bunch of morals. It's not you becoming a better person that, oh, I was, you know, a drug addict, an alcoholic, or whatever before I was saved, and then I came to the church, and now I'm living right for God. A lot of people say that they won't come to church because they got to clean up their act first. But yet God says in Romans 5:8, but God commendeth his love toward us, and that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. He didn't wait until we clean up our lives, because we can't clean up our lives. Romans 7 verse 18 says that in my flesh dwelleth no good thing. And so when we recognize it's a spiritual thing, it's not the flesh that we're battling with. It's allowing the Spirit to control our souls and have be strengthened with might in the inner man by God's Word, and allow God's Word to control our decisions rather than the lust of the flesh. Then we recognize where the true battle is, and then we focus on that. And when you focus on the mind, then you can allow the doctrine to come into you, a great and work through you. A great example to go along with that is sports. If you've read, I've read like a Jamie Moyer biography. He was a pitcher in the major leagues up until the age of 47. Rafael Nadal, who is one of the greatest tennis players of all time, I've read his biography. If you read sports, I'm sure other ones, if you've read other sports biographies, what you'll find is that the reason they become the players that they are, become great players, is because they are able to control the mind. You know, Jamie Moyer, I mentioned, he was a pitcher, had a lot of talent, but his best years were in his 30s and 40s, when his body wasn't at its peak like it was in the 20s. And the reason is because in the 20s, he didn't have the mind to take out the crowd and not focus on the crowd. In other words, there's a lot of the flesh going on. Or Rafael Nadal, for example, when he's playing tennis, if you're out there playing and you're thinking about what the other person, you know, how good the other person is, or you're thinking about how nervous you are with all the crowd watching you and the people on TV and that, and you get focused on that, then you lose focus on what you're trying to do in the game. And in both of those biographies, and I'm sure other sports people, they'll tell you that they have to focus on what they're doing. They have to think about, okay, what shot am I going to hit next? What's my game plan? Or what pitches am I going to throw? And then they block out the crowd, and they block out their opponent, and stop thinking about that, and just focus on what they need to do, the task at hand. And that's when they've got their mind focused and controlled, so that they can do what they need to do. And that's exactly what the Christian life is like. Christianity has us focused on taking communion and water baptism and being on the serve team and talking about how I love my church and just all these things of the flesh. Let's pray about sister so-and-so who stubbed her toe, or let's pray for the physical healing of this person who has cancer. And they look at all these things that focus, you know, what about a job? Oh, somebody is going traveling. Let's pray for traveling mercies. And they focus on the physical and focus on the flesh and try to take care of that. And when you do that, you're not focused, you don't have your mind focused where it should be. Your focus needs to be on God and His Word and the doctrine. That's why 1 Thessalonians 5:17 says, pray without ceasing. Obviously, you don't have your head bowed and prayed. If I did that now, I had my eyes closed, I'd be in a wreck and kill myself within a few minutes here. You can't pray, but yet I'm told to pray without ceasing. So that doesn't mean bowing your head, closing your eyes, although you can certainly do that at times. You can't do that all the time. You know, I've got to do my job. I can't be at work and they say, well, why didn't you pay everybody? You know, it's your job to get the checks out to pay the vendors. Well, I had my eyes closed. I had to pray all the time. God told me to pray. My obligation to God is higher than yours, so I couldn't do it. You know, I get fired immediately. So praying without ceasing is that mindset where because I've got God's Word in my heart, I read it, then every decision I make is important. Even the simplest things, like I'm at work and an angry vendor calls because they haven't been paid. It's a conversation between me and the vendor, but yet with people around me will hear what I do. If I blow up and I start yelling at them, well, now I'm a bad example to my coworkers. I'm not sharing God's love to that vendor. And so it's something, if I've got the doctrine inside me, then I talk to the vendor, and even though they're being ridiculous, I can keep calm, and I can think about how Christ loved me, and He wants His love to come through me so that others may be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. And so then I keep my cool with that vendor, and I handle it calmly. Or, you know, a situation, coworkers, or whatever it is. But praying without ceasing means that I'm always thinking, I've always got my mind focused, just like that tennis player or that baseball player. I'm not thinking about outward circumstances that I can't control. I can't control that the crowd boos me, or the crowd cheers me, or the crowd's yelling my name, or that people are at home and, you know, they advertising a contract that I signed with Nike is riding on me having a good performance in this game, or what, you know, those are things that you just can't control. What Nike does with the contract, what the fans do, those are just circumstances. And the good players block all that stuff out and they get their focus on the task at hand, saying, what's the next pitch I throw? How do I throw it? Or what's the next ball that I hit? How do I hit it? And it's the same thing with the Christian life. It's not about me thinking about all the physical circumstances that I can't control or manipulating circumstances. It's a battle of the mind. It's being laser focused. It's praying without ceasing. And if I don't know the scripture, then when I'm asking myself as I pray, you know, over whatever situation is, no matter how big or how small, I'm making, you know, thousands of decisions every day. That decision, I'm going to make it based on the sound doctrine that's in the inner man and not upon how I feel or the circumstances or the lust of the flesh, but I base it upon the sound doctrine. If I haven't read the Bible, haven't read the scripture, maybe I don't know how I'm supposed to act. Just like somebody you know, wrongs me at work and they apologize. Well, if I don't know Ephesians 4:32 to be kind, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, then I don't know that I'm to forgive that person. Maybe I think, you know, an eye for an eye, a tooth for a tooth, and I'm trying to pour out my own vengeance upon them by not forgiving them. I need to know God's Word, and I need to know it rightly divided and have it in the inner man so that when it comes time to make a decision, then I can think about it. That's what prayer is all about. It's just talking it over in your mind with God about what you're supposed to do. And then you win the battle. What's the task at hand? The task at hand is that I've been wronged by my coworker. Well, how do I handle that? If I know the scripture, I know that I should be willing to forgive them, that I should be kind and move on from there. If I don't know the scripture, I don't know that. So I have to pray without ceasing, but I also have to know the scripture. I mentioned Ephesians 6. we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers. Well, in that armor, I mentioned that the sword of the Spirit is the Word of God. That's the only offensive weapon in the armor. But then, the next thing that says, and taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, it says, praying always with all prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving. And that is a continuation from taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. After it says, taking the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God, there is not a period. There is a colon. In your King James Bible, it's a colon. And a colon means what comes after the colon defines what's before the colon. And what comes after the colon is to pray always with all prayer and supplication. And so what that tells me then is that the definition of how I use the sword of the Spirit, how I use the Word of God, is that I pray it in my mind. But if I don't have it in my mind, I can't use it. It doesn't do me any good when it's on a Bible on the bookshelf collecting dust. It needs to be in my mind. I need to be strengthened with might in the inner man by the Holy Spirit, Ephesians 3:16. And he does that by teaching me the Word of God, 1 Corinthians 2, verses 8 through 16. And so we need to be, when it comes to our Christian lives, it's that battle of the mind, and we need to be laser focused on the task at hand, just like that sports star does. We need to know God's Word so that whatever situation comes up, just like that, I mentioned Rafael Nadal, when he's playing, you know, when he was coming up in his career, he didn't face the top players in the world because he was still new. He didn't know how to handle the top players in the world because they're better. They have better shots. You know, how your strategy for playing the number one person in the world is a lot different from playing the number 100 person in the world. You got to know your opponent. And it's the same thing when it comes to your Christian life. You've got all different types of circumstances. Some things are easy to deal with. Some things are hard. I mentioned the coworker. Well, that's just a matter of keeping your emotions in check and knowing that God wants you to forgive them. But then there are a lot harder decisions that you come up with. Like, what about if I lose my job? You know, and I've got offers. Like the last time, a couple years ago, I lost my job and I had offers in California. I had an offer in Alabama. How do you make that decision? There's nothing wrong with any of those jobs. There isn't really a right or wrong, but you've got to look at all these different factors and then take the emotions out of it and figure out what's the best case as far as people being saved, coming into the knowledge of the truth, and of course for yourself as well, coming into the knowledge of the truth. And when you've got difficult decisions like that, it's not an easy thing. You know, figuring out who to marry, for example. The Lord says, as long as they're in the Lord, that's okay. And, there's a lot of, those big decisions that we call it. They're no different from the small decisions in that you use God's Word and pray without ceasing. But the only difference is it takes a lot more prayer. It takes a lot more God's Word. And the more you know and the more you're focused on the task at hand and you take the emotions out of it and you just allow your spirit to control you rather than your flesh, you need more of God's Word and you need to be more advanced, just like that Rafael Nadal needs to be more advanced to beat those top players. And so when it comes to big decisions like that, you need God's Word. So it shows how important it is to know the Scripture rightly divided, to understand it, to read it, to believe what it says, and not only that, but to apply it. Paul says, knowledge puffeth up, but charity edifieth. You can have the knowledge, and just by itself, it doesn't do any good. You have to apply it. And it's the charity or the love of God that's shed abroad in your hearts by the Holy Ghost, Romans 5:5, coupled with that knowledge that causes you to walk in the Spirit, to be led by the Spirit, for Christ to live in you. And that all starts with knowing God's Word rightly divided. Just like Rafael Nadal cannot beat the top player in the world if he doesn't have advanced knowledge of tennis and the techniques to use in order to beat the very top opponent. So too, you will never defeat Satan in your battles and in your wrestling against the principalities and powers if you do not have advanced sound doctrine in your mind for those more difficult situations that you face. And so basically that's all I had to say for today. But I wanted to let you know that it is a battle of the mind, because Christianity gets you to focus on the flesh, because people, according to 2 Timothy 4:3, they have itching ears and they will not endure sound doctrine. They turn their ears from the truth. And so Christianity doesn't follow sound doctrine in teaching the truth. They teach fables. They teach things that will bring the crowds in, that will scratch their itching ears so that they will continue to come, so that their lust of the flesh are satisfied, so that they will give money to the church. And with that out there, we need to be focused. That's one of those distractions, believe it or not. The church is supposed to be the pillar and ground of the truth, and yet it's one of the major distractions out there from your Christian walk, because they're telling you things, focusing you on the flesh, focusing on the material, focus on physical health, when God is focusing on spiritual health. He's focusing on spiritual maturity. He's focusing on the things of the Spirit to teach you, and so that you can be an example of the love of Christ to others, so that they may be saved and come into the knowledge of the truth. With Christianity being that distraction, we need to block that out of our minds, just like a sports star blocks the crowd out of his mind and doesn't let them affect them, even though they're right there in the arena. He blocks them out. So too, as Christians, we need to block out the world. We need to block out what Christianity says when it's contrary to God's word, and have that laser sharp focus on God's word and what he says, and understanding it, so that we have that sound doctrine built up in the inner man, in our minds, so that when we have the opportunity, we use the mind of Christ, praying without ceasing, praying it in our minds, so that we make the decision that's based on sound doctrine rather than on the flesh. All right, thank you for joining us.